Hello, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Bradley Fisher, and I'm an Educational Technology Coordinator in Chicago Public Schools and a passionate advocate for computer science and STEM education. It's my pleasure to bring you the 20th webinar in this series hosted by NCWIT Counselors for Computing. Each month, we connect you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. This series offers unique opportunities to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, also known as CS plus X. Throughout the presentation, we would love for you to submit questions through the Q&A feature on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. We will also be sharing resources in the chat feature, also found on the toolbar at the bottom of the screen. The National Center for Women and Information Technology, or NCWIT, is a nonprofit community of more than 1,500 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women in computing existed mostly in isolation, without the benefit of shared best practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. Today, these programs are part of the NCWIT community, creating a far greater impact than if institutions acted alone. Counselors for Computing, or C4C, is one of the programs in the NCWIT K-12 Alliance. NCWIT Counselors for Computing, C4C, program provides information and resources that help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people, programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. We wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships, and scholarships for students and many career development opportunities for educators. We share their website in the chat for you to learn more. I would now like to introduce you to our speaker today. Dr. Rebecca Bowers-Gentry started life thinking about becoming a medical doctor in the field of pediatrics or a physical therapist. After volunteer experience in both during high school, she began her education at the local community college. At the community college, her love for science and education developed from her classes and tutoring. She transferred to San Diego State University to receive her Bachelor's of Science degree in cell and molecular biology and worked in a lab at the Burnham Institute, where her interest in bench science flourished. After graduating, she worked at a local biotechnology company working on human cell patches for tissue replacement for burn victims and diabetic foot ulcer patients. She also went on to pursue her PhD in pharmacology from the University of Colorado Health Science Center, and then moved to the University of California, San Diego for a postdoctoral research opportunity. While doing postdoc research, she began her teaching career at the same community college she attended as a student. She is currently a professor of biology and chemistry, as well as runs the biotechnology training program at Miramar College. She has a family and loves traveling and is a sports enthusiast. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Bowers-Gentry.
Thank you for having me. I just needed to get technologically set up. So thank you for having me. I'm going to share my slides, and hopefully you'll get a good feel for what the biotechnology world looks like and possibilities for students in this area. So I'm going to start by talking about the idea that scientists actually live and work in lots of areas. So even though we talk about the biotechnology industry and that scientists are typically driven into working in the industry, we also have to realize that that scientists end up in law and working in malpractice or policy, and they end up in government, and they end up in journalism because we need writers to write to and speak to science, and then in criminal justice and in healthcare. So I think it's really important to start the conversation by saying, as students are interested in the sciences and in STEM, there really is a wide variety of places that they can end up in their careers. So let's start by talking about what biotechnology is. At its simplest, biotechnology is the technology based on biology. It is essentially taking cellular and biomolecular processes that to develop technologies and products that help improve our lives and the health of our planet. I'm going to give you some examples in just a minute. We've used the biological processes of microorganisms for years, thousands of years, in fact, things like breads and cheeses and dairy products, et cetera. But I think the important part to understand is that biotechnology is really an interdisciplinary science. It connects chemistry, engineering, and biology, and I'll talk a lot about that today. And it really brings together those disciplines, and creating products is the intention. I'd be remiss if I didn't spend some time talking about the idea that computer science is really critical to the industries that we serve. And bioinformatics is the connectedness between computer science, statistics, and biology, and really critical and up-and-coming skills that are critical to our industry as well. So I just wanted to take a second and talk about the areas of biotechnology, and it's kind of grown tremendously in the last 10 to 15 years, and the last 30 to 50 years. And these colors actually have expanded into areas that won't have colors in the future because there's so many of them. But I'd like to talk kind of generally about why students get into this field. Maybe you have a student that's interested in cancer research and they're interested in treating cancer. So they're interested in the process by which the cancers form through genetics. And then the next step would be to investigate that, do research and development, and eventually end up with drug development. So it's one way students might become interested in this process. Maybe they live in the Midwest and they're definitely, their families are influenced by farming and agricultural. So they might come up with different probiotics and chemical products for farm animals or for crops. Another area that's really important to think about is that students are really interested in the computer science world. So understanding how we utilize data, how we analyze data, and how we store data are really important areas. I'm going to expand on those kind of three areas, but note that there's so many areas of biotechnology that include human welfare, industrial and manufacturing applications, food processing, and biological warfare, for instance. So some examples I just wanted to kind of bring to light. Bioinformatics is a really important area. It brings the connectedness of chemistry, biochemistry, biology, statistics. For instance, if you take a crime scene lab and you get data from that crime scene, that will eventually lead us to do an analysis. And that analysis requires us to use computers, be able to store that data properly, and analyze it, usually through computer processing. Another area that students tend to find interest is the drug development process. Drug development is a very long process. It can take 8 to 15 years to bring a drug to market, and that's after research and development. And there's many different areas that students can be involved in here. So we have researchers, we have compliance officers, quality assurance and quality control. We have medical doctors, pharmacists. We have clinical researchers, all the way up into the FDA and understanding the data and providing data analysis. And an example is when we brought insulin to market, and that's a really important process to be able to bring those drugs, medications for a disease treatment to the consumer product. Last one I'll just mention is agricultural biotechnology. This tends to be one of those really hot areas right now, especially when we talk about things like biofuels and food securities. We can make rice that is actually has vitamin D added to it. So there's lots of ways that we can that utilize biotechnology in the agricultural field as well. Taking from that, I just wanted to kind of take a step back and say, where does biotechnology exist in the United States? It's everywhere. So there's not a place really that doesn't have some sort of biotechnology presence. I think the important part to think about is what do the communities and the society in that area need? And that's typically where the biotechnology industry emphasis are, or that area is. So for example, in San Diego, we have Biotech Beach, San Francisco's Biotech Bay, the Midwest has biotech, and specifically more in agricultural areas. And then Genetown and Farm Country, those are pharmaceuticals up in Massachusetts, et cetera. And then Florida is another kind of area that is important. And I just wanted to show this next slide, because I think it's important to understand what type of employers there are, how big they are, and that they actually exist in multiple areas. So for instance, if we look at this slide, we see Amgen in San Francisco, which is Biotech Bay, and Biotech Beach, which is San Diego, and in Genetown, which is in Massachusetts. So we have employers that actually exist in multiple regions in the areas of biotech. And that allows for students to become trained, get employed in a particular, but also move. So they don't necessarily have to stay grounded in whatever community they're living in at the time. The other thing that I just wanted to mention is that most of these employers are on the best lists of large and small employer lists quite often. So it's just something to keep in mind as we're going through this process. I wanted to speak just generally about why biotech. Why do students become involved, and why in neighborhoods and communities is it important? One, the market grows every year, about 6% every year for the last 5 years. Obviously, we have specific implications with that, with COVID and other needs, but it definitely has an increased market value. And that's really important when we think about how we're going to inform students about what their careers could look like and how we could help them gain a valuable career. And I find when I talk to students the most that they're interested in helping other people. And this is one way, becoming engaged in the biotech community and the scientific community, that is really about helping people and helping people live better and providing a better quality of life. I also wanted to mention in San Diego, about 72,000 employees in San Diego, and they vary in research and development, medical devices, which is a lot like a COVID test. The creation of the COVID test and diagnostics was in that medical device area. Biopharmaceuticals or drug development, biotechnology specifically is about product making, and then scientific research tools and agriculture. So it's really important to know kind of the community you live in, the community you'd like to live in as a student, and trying to get an idea of how you might fit into biotech. And I'll talk a little bit about the educational process that's important for that. So I pulled this information from a report from Massachusetts, actually, and I think it's important to kind of think about what's it going to take for a student to get where they'd like to be, either in research and development or bringing products to market or making a new COVID type test, diagnostic test. But I think it was important to think about what type of education they would need. And so that's what I'm going to kind of talk about for the rest of the time. I think what's important here is to note, and if you look at the left slide, it shows that students 20% of students only need a high school diploma or a GED to work in the biotech or life sciences field. That's critical to understand that not every student that ends up in the biotech area actually spent any time at the college level. They might have had some really important STEM experience in their high school area, high school years. They might have had an internship in the process. They might have become employed in manufacturing because they had a good hands-on skill set. So it's really important to remember that there are really good places for students to become employed with high school or GED experience. The next step is to remember that that associate's degrees and programs like ours that I'll describe in just a minute have a really relevant place in areas like San Diego that have a biotech presence, need entry-level employees as well. A majority of the United States employees in the sector and the life sciences jobs typically have bachelor's degrees. Not all, 43% or so, but that's just something to keep in mind that students might end up employed with no experience and then end up the next step getting into a bachelor's degree program. And then the last part of this is to think about what higher education after a bachelor's degree could look like. It could be in a master's, it could be a PhD. But again, the employment rates for someone with a master's or PhD isn't that as comparable to a bachelor's degree. Ashley, you mentioned what kind of high school graduation requirements do they need for me for a degree in biotech? I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. So thanks for bringing that up. I think this slide is probably the crux of understanding what people can do in our life sciences industry and really get to what the level of employment they could have based on the education that they have. So in a high school or an associate's degree, so very little or little to none experience, students can be laboratory assistants or employees can be laboratory assistants. They can be quality control technicians. They can handle working in the infrastructure or manufacturing areas. They could be sales specialists if they really understand what that technology does, or they could end up in educational aid or graphic designer. And I want to put a big plug in here. I think it's really important to have cross-disciplinary and interdisciplinary trained students. A student that has and is getting a graphic arts degree or a computer science degree or a design can really have a very nice career in this area if they understand how to represent science and be able to visually make it appealing in marketing and sales, et cetera. Bachelor's degrees, you can end up in areas of employment like an engineer, life scientists, which is like a biological research scientist. You can end up in safety management. And then in the operations and management business side, you could end up in as a understanding the business analytics of the operations and how good the business is running. And then they can end up in writing and editing. So someone that might have an English degree, but also a STEM interest might end up as an editor, could be a public affairs specialist if they end up with a communications degree, or scientific illustrator if they're interested in arts, et cetera. Advanced degrees, so masters and PhDs end up usually as lead engineers. They're typically running labs, project management, scientist positions, engineers, architects. They typically end up in the kind of management or administrative roles of the companies, and that ends up being important for the management of that area in the biotech industry. They also might end up in community outreach. There is a really big intention with biotechnology industry to reach to the community. So having community events and so that's maybe an education program manager, for instance. So this kind of shows you in a STEM field, at a biotechnology industry company, kind of the areas that people with different emphasis might be interested in getting employed. So I think the next step was to kind of think about the education at the college level, and I'll come back to the point about high school requirements. Most requirements are from a high school perspective. What do they need to take in high school to make them probably that best candidate for the university or the community college? Chemistry, biology, and physics, probably those three classes at the high school level are the underpinning information that they're going to need as they move into the university level. Our local high schools have biotechnology classes at the high school level. They also have medical interventions classes. So anything that kind of exposes them more to the science that they might be interested in so that they can start to discover what their passion might be, those are the reasons. They also have, I'm thinking of other local high schools, sports medicine, that just continues that exposure of science. And I'll give you some suggestions later on in terms of other ways that students might become interested in the sciences world. There's multiple entry points and pathways. I just put this slide up because I think it's important to think about. From high school, students can come into the industry many different ways. First way is they could go straight to a four-year institution at a university. They could major in biotechnology, biomanufacturing, biology, biomedical engineering, bioengineering, chemistry, biology, biochemistry, chemical engineering, engineering, all of which are important. But I also want to be mindful that we should include computer science degrees, marketing, business, sales, technical support, legal, computer, all of those are really important. And having a really good working knowledge, even at the university level for our STEM students in a variety of areas actually is really important. That's what we use for critical thinking skills and problem solving. So to have really a wide range of interests here is important for STEM majors. They could end up going to a university. And then end up coming back to a biotechnology program to get some basic hands-on skills. There are a number of universities that do a good job doing hands-on skill training, but there's a variety of colleges that also, while they provide the lab experience, don't spend time really training students for jobs and employment. And so we call them bounce backs, but I think it's important to note that that community college biotechnology programs actually can be really beneficial for those students that are coming from the university that don't quite have the experience that they're looking for in maybe mammalian cell culture, polymerase chain reaction, we call PCR, or specific techniques that are critical to the industry as well. The alternative pathway is to start here at the community college program, move into a university and on a transfer process. You'll have the hands-on skills. The students will have the hands-on skills. They'll transfer to the university in some way. That'll be a combination of probably 5 to 6 years of education there in preparation for a job. So really B and C is very comparable. It's just the timing and where they enter. The community college system in California is great. We currently offer 2 years for free in the San Diego Promise and California Promise programs. So it's really a nice way for students to kind of get into the programs that they might be interested in. This is the place that I would say spend a lot of time exploring to your students. Explore what you would like to do. That's one way at the community college that they can spend some time taking a business class, taking a communications class that really gives them a feel for what types of areas they might be interested in, even as a STEM major. And then students come directly to us at our biotechnology program, and within a year and a half, they can be employed in a job. So there's direct entry employment as well with some basic hands-on skill training. And I'll describe that in just a minute. I just wanted to mention that I think it's important to note that there are 2-year, 4-year institutions across the United States that have biotechnology specific training and education. And you'll see here in the dark blue, that most of them are represented. Actually, we're not even in San Diego. We're not represented with by a dark blue dot that says biotechnology college programs. But all of those dark blue dots are two-year institutions that are offering some sort of training like ours. And then in addition, all of the lighter blue dots are all the four-year biotechnology specific college programs. And then the biotechnology community spaces, that means that there's labs out there that are doing technical training. They don't need to be associated with an institution. And then the next step, I'm going to take a big step back. Most institutions, four-year institutions and two-year institutions, have biology, chemistry, engineering, pre-engineering programs. So if a student's really interested in the biotech field, but they don't want to live in any of these regions, they should be looking at a four-year institution that has a biology program with some interests in biotechnology and getting some experience. I just blew this slide up a little bit, which is just California. And just to show you that we really have some unique programs here in biotechnology and biomanufacturing. And even at the two-year institutions, there are a number of bachelor's degree programs, so four-year programs at the two-year institutions. And so that ends up making it much more affordable, easy to apply, easier to apply to. It's still a competitive process. But we have one locally that's about 30 minutes from San Diego Miramar College that is a four-year biomanufacturing program at the two-year school. It costs about $10,000 once they're done with their first 2 years for their third and fourth year to earn their biomanufacturing degree. There we go. So our program, just so you have an idea of kind of what the biotechnology programs at a two-year institution would look like, we provide 300 hours of hands-on training in a number of classes. We have four classes that lead to a certificate. We have the ability for those four classes to be turned into an associate's degree as well. But our intention is to listen to the industry and ask the industry what's of the most need in terms of technical training. And then we embed that into our courses. So things like PCR, immunological techniques, ELISA. And then we spend time training students. Unlike a typical biology lab or chemistry lab, this is providing those technical skills that allow them to be employable. And then we offer that quality and regulatory practices class that really speaks to the quality philosophies that are inherent in our industry. And it was important for me to think about, how do students find their way into biotech? They find their way because they're interested in chemistry, they're interested in biology, they're interested in data analysis or computer science. And those hard skills are probably of the greatest demand for our industry. And you see that in kind of the right part of the slide, where chemistry, biology, project management, experiments, validation are all there. But I would be remiss if I didn't mention that our industry, biotechnology industry and life sciences industry, is extremely devoted and pays particular attention to soft skills, presentation skills, communication skills, attention to detail, being able to speak clearly, and really those business savvy soft skills are really important to our industry. So students can really spend some time in the high school level and in kind of early college honing those skills so that they can become better in terms of employment and employability as they exit whatever educational process they're doing. We spend a lot of time in our program on soft skills. And just kind of come back full circle to this idea of the fact that the careers in biotechnology are not just STEM related. They can end up being in project management, research and development. They could be scientists that are actually doing the research, but they also might be scientists that are thinking about how to analyze the data in the IT program at that industry company. They could be in the marketing and sales area. And if they can speak science at the same time that they're trying to market it and sell it, even better. So that's really an important part of this idea of how to make it really clear that students can fit in lots of different areas. They may end up in venture capital and raising billions of dollars for companies. But if they can speak that science, they understand the science behind what they're trying to sell, really important as well. And then patent law, intellectual property, also a really important part of our industry. I use this slide because I wanted to kind of bring full circle this idea that biochemistry majors, if we're looking at four-year degrees and you're not looking at, you know, and you're helping students kind of move to the next step, and it's not a two-year institution that they're interested in or a biotechnology training program, really students should pursue their passion. They could end up in chemistry, they could end up in biology, they could combine the two and end up in biochemistry, engineering, they didn't have a really good slide for that, are really good areas. Everything with the yellow star you see here are areas, food scientists, there's a local biotech company here that's making cell-based foods and seafood, and that's science in biotech, biochemists and pharmaceuticals making new drugs, pharmacists that are helping the drug development process and clinical trials. So there's lots of different ways that students can fit into the industry. I think it's really important for them to realize that they could pursue their passion in whatever science they're most interested in, and then end up kind of moving into the industry based on those skills and that interest and what they're most passionate about. Maybe it's cancer research, maybe it's engineering of a new cell, or stem cell research, or making new products, really important. And the last thing I wanted to kind of mention on this slide is it's important to think about the fact that computer science is inherently important in our industry. There's not a job on that list of things that students could be trained in that would they would be clearly qualified to work in our industry. Web designing, it's really important for our industry to have really nice, well-designed web pages, data analysis, data storage, databasing, all of that fits into computer science careers. They already talked about my experience, but I'll just mention that I started here at Miramar. I think it's really important to think about how students can fulfill their role, start of their education in the community college. I did spend some time in internships, again, work-based learning activities, really, really critical. Loved the science that I did both in the company that I worked for and in my PhD research, which was lipid inflammatory research of the lung. And then I've spent a majority of the last 17 years educating students to get into our industry and into STEM career fields. Last, I'll just mention it's important that students realize how diverse getting a biology degree really can be. They can end up in so many different areas and in training, biotechnology training, really different areas, and they can pursue what their interests are. And the last thing I just wanted to mention is I think it's really important too when we're talking to students and mentoring students that we really give them an idea of suggestions, things like pursuing experiential learning. I ended up where I was because I did an internship, I volunteered, I job shadowed, I talked to people, did informational interviews, I spent time talking to college students and people doing the jobs that I was interested in. Now I produce a lot of tours and field trips and virtual tours and virtual presentations for students to experience. Career panels, talking to people that have been through the program and ended up where you might want to be, and guest speakers. Working at trying to find a mentor in the field that they're interested in, and that they most importantly follow their passion and explore the fields as much as possible. At the high school level, and then when they get to college, I would really suggest getting involved in STEM clubs, STEM outreach, community outreach activities, etc. I'm going to stop there because I think I'm close to time. I do have a page of resources. I'll just mention they're going to provide you the link for this as well. I'm just going to mention a few things that have come up in the Q&A. It says the soft skills are so important for employability. What does job placement look like after students complete your program? Almost 100% employability. We don't do placement. So I don't say student A, you're going to this job. But we have any student that's really seeking employment is going to find employment fairly easily. Southern California is really, really hot in terms of biotech and has great entry-level employment. and do all fine jobs in the industry that they are seeking. Yeah, if they're going after it and they're really interested, they're putting their resume in. We do resume building work in our workshops, et cetera, and our classes. If they're really interested in that process of getting to employment, there isn't someone that I haven't found that really has been continued to struggle. They may be laid off. They come back. I just met with a student last week, and we're talking about how to the next steps for her as well. So those soft skills, really important. Persistence, perseverance, understanding what the industry looks like. That's all really important. And the last one I'll just mention is, do most biotech degree programs require computer science courses? Some, but not all. It really depends on the four-year degree that you go into, the areas, et cetera, that your students are interested in. There usually is some sort of embedded bioinformatics. So how do we use databases to investigate DNA, for instance, and DNA genes, et cetera, and mutations and how that leads to disease. Those are usually embedded in the classes. But not all of them require you to take separate computer science classes. So that's a great question. I just put up this last slide because I think it's really an important slide, because it has a lot of other resources. All of the slides that I've made are PDF available to you by link. And these ones on the back page, the last number of them are all about our biotech program. But more importantly, the one that's highlighted in yellow actually takes you to a careers page where students can explore, what does it mean to be a technician? What does it mean to work in quality control? What types of education levels do you need for that in the industry? And so it's a really, that highlighted yellow one is one that I would highly recommend. I think I covered the Q&A, but I'll stop sharing and go from there.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bowers-Gentry, for that fascinating presentation and for addressing those Q&A questions that came in over the chat on the fly. We have a few others that we'd like to ask you, if that's okay.
Absolutely.
Thank you. What does the admissions process look like to San Diego Miramar biotech programs? How competitive is it? What sets a student apart, would you say?
So because we're a two-year institution, we are open entry, which means that a student can enroll at our college, like any other two-year institution with open entry. They can enroll in the college, they can register for classes. They could potentially have priority depending on special needs, disabilities, student services, they're a true freshman, those sorts of things. Currently, actually, our classes aren't completely full, which is just fine. We really encourage students to apply and enroll and come take classes to get some really good hands-on experience. So we don't have a competitive enrollment process. It's an open enrollment process. They enroll in the college. They can register for classes at the same time everyone else does. The four-year institutions will have a competitive enrollment process. So okay. Just like another four-year institution applying to San Diego State or UCSD, at least in our region, will have that competitive enrollment process where they apply, GPA matters, that sort of thing. The nice thing at community college, GPA doesn't matter. Your experience doesn't matter. You come here, you get the experience, you can go to employment. I think that answered most of your question.
Absolutely. Yeah, fascinating. Thank you. You talked a little bit about your own educational journey, but can you tell us a little more about what led you to this career and what makes you passionate about biotechnology?
Yeah, I kind of grapple with that sometimes. I think my tutoring experience from the very beginning at community college sets it apart for me, because I really spent a lot of time thinking about how to teach students and passionate about helping students get to where they want to be. So that was my first kind of experience. The other part was that I was a community college student myself. So I believe in the system, and I believe in kind of the idea that students can really spend time exploring what they would like at this level. Nice thing, like I said, in California, they can do that without it being financially challenging. And then they can explore, do I really love chemistry? Do I really love biology? Get involved in some of the STEM activities. So that was probably my first, was that just coming to community college and then getting some tutoring experience.
Okay.
The second was the first time I got a teaching class, right? When I first started teaching as a postdoc, I wasn't required to teach as a TA in my graduate studies. I just did complete research project work. And I think it was really beneficial for me. And I started teaching at the community college level. Loved the class sizes, loved the interaction with students. I keep my door open, so if students want to walk in, they can come say hi. Mm-hmm. I wanted that type of personal experience with students and didn't want to teach at the four-year institutions where I could be obligated, not that I'm not already with education, but could be obligated for other work. And so that's where the second part of that is. And then all along the way, I learned to love bench science. I love working at the lab. I like working with my hands. I like problem solving. In my PhD research, I was trained on mass spectrometers, which are like million-dollar machines, and we learned to take them apart and put them back together. And I loved it. So that's where I was like, that's what I want to do forever. And I love, you know, working in the lab. And then I realized that I really wanted to teach students how to work in the lab. And so that connectedness between my experiences was led me here.
I see. Yes, so many different things that you like fit right into the career that you have. So that's wonderful.
Exactly.
Because this is a program from NCWIT, through C4C or Counselors for Computing, this next question kind of speaks to that. Did you receive encouragement and guidance from your middle and high school educators? And what types of support could you have used more of?
It's a great question. I remember back, and my most probably influential teacher wasn't a science teacher. It was my AP English teacher. And and then previous to that was my 10th grade English teacher. And my 10th grade English teacher said, you need to work a little harder. You're smart. Keep going.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow. Okay. So I never really heard that from anyone until 10th grade. And so that teacher was really important and influential to me because she's like, you're kind of like just doing the do. And I said, yeah, you're probably right. I'm just doing the do. And I ended up going into the advanced classes and ended up in science. And a lot of my experience that way came from just that influence. Then with my English teacher, my AP English teacher in 12th grade, she just loved what she did. And she passed that passion of finding your passion on to people and to her students. And so she never kind of let us flounder. And if you don't like English, that's okay, but just find mm-hmm. what you're passionate about. And that was probably the most important message to me after you need to work harder. I was like, oh, okay. The second one was, or you're capable of doing more, I guess was the first message. And then the second message was, don't do anything you're not passionate about in life. And so that's where those two teachers, so not science related at all.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's really fascinating that you got so much support from English teachers mm-hmm. across your journey.
Yeah.
Really interesting. So I think we have time for one more question.
Okay.
So what advice would you give to students considering a coursework or careers in biotechnology? And to follow up with that on that question, what would you suggest school counselors do to help support these students?
So for the student aspect, I would say find what you really like about science. It doesn't have to be at a bench. It doesn't need to be in a typical medical environment. It doesn't need to be a, you can kind of design your own way. You could end up a STEM major and a four-year degree and end up going to law school because you're really passionate about law. interested in intellectual property, et cetera. So that's the kind of thing that I think it's important to for the students to recognize. I've had two of my daughters that have ended up going to college in science. And I think one thing that they really learned from their counselors was how to career explore. So either using the systems that are available, I would say, you know, use the counselors really utilize those tools to be able to design opportunities for students and continue to connect to the community colleges, to the universities, to people that are working in the industry, and bring them onto your campus, talk to them, have the students be able to talk to them. If you don't know someone like that, reach out to community college faculty. That's one thing that we're really good at, is really trying to make connections, especially for high school students. And I just want to mention one thing in the Q&A that came up. Are certifications important for students to have?
Yes.
And it says, if so, what types of certifications? It's a good question. If they come from if they're trained at Miramar College, they're going to earn a certificate of achievement. It's three courses. It's just something on their transcript. The most important thing is actually the skills and the classes that they learned. So that's probably the most important certification. There are other third-party certifications. One that comes to mind is made by the American Society for Quality for a class that we teach. There's a certification exam that goes along with that class. We don't provide the certification itself, but they can take that. So there's ways to end up being certified in specific areas. Another mention I'll just say really quick, and I know that we're almost out of time, is that a lot of schools like UCSD have professional schools next to them. So at UCSD, it's called UCSD Extension, and it's kind of an additive type of education. They have certifications in things like project management and biofuels and some other areas that actually allow students to learn other concepts or techniques or skills that are also applicable to their resume. And that those any types of certifications you can put on your resume, the better with the skill set.
That's super helpful information. Thank you. And that's all the time we do have for questions. Thank you so much for sharing all of your knowledge and information about the biotechnology industry.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
Process. Absolutely. So we hope that you all out there will join us for our next webinar on May 11th, or view past webinars by going to the link that's in the chat. Finally, take a look out for a survey in your email within the next few days. Responding to the survey will enter you into a drawing for a $100 Amazon gift card and resource kit. We thank you for your responses and for joining us today, and we hope to see you at our next webinar in May. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Bowers-Gentry.